بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. External abdominal hernia. This means protrusion of abdominal viscus or part of abdominal viscus through a defect in the anterior abdominal wall. This is the difference, and this is the main difference between external abdominal hernia and the internal abdominal hernia. In external abdominal hernia, the defect occurs in the abdominal wall. Therefore, once the abdominal viscus protrudes from the defect in the anterior abdominal wall, the hernia appears as a swelling on the surface of the abdomen, and therefore called external abdominal hernia. While in internal abdominal hernia, the defect deeply in the abdomen and the hernia deep and does not appear on the surface of the abdomen, therefore it is called internal hernia. What is the etiology of hernia? To understand the etiology better, we should mention the pathology and the structure of the hernia first. What is the structure of any hernia? This is a picture showing the structure of any hernia. This is a normal anterior abdominal wall in this region. The abdominal wall in any region is formed of skin, subcutaneous fat, this white area representing subcutaneous fat, followed by muscle layer. Usually the muscle layer formed of three muscles in the anterior abdominal wall: external abdominal oblique, internal abdominal oblique, and transversus abdominis. The muscle layer followed by extra peritoneal fat, and this dark thick line representing the parietal peritoneum. And the parietal peritoneum like this layer of nylon. Then inside the parietal peritoneum, there is the peritoneal cavity and abdominal contents and the abdominal viscera, like this content, which is a small intestine. Hernia to occur should present first by a defect. The first thing occur in the hernia is defect in the abdominal wall, and through this defect the increase, first of all, why this defect occur? Usually defect in the abdominal wall and in the muscle of the abdominal wall usually occur due to weakness of muscles in the abdominal wall, and through this defect the parietal peritoneum protrude and herniate outside the abdomen. Why the parietal peritoneum protrude through the defect and herniate outside the abdomen? Usually there is increase intra-abdominal pressure pushing the parietal peritoneum through the defect outside the abdominal wall. Like that, the condition starts by a defect in the abdominal wall, and the parietal peritoneum lines the abdominal wall. Increase intra-abdominal pressure will push the parietal peritoneum through the defect outside the abdomen, leading to a hernial sac. Therefore, the hernial sac is the layer of the parietal peritoneum, which protrude outside the defect. Any hernial sac is formed of three parts: neck, body, and fundus. Fundus. It is described as neck, body, and fundus, like the gallbladder, because the hernial sac usually biriform in shape, like the gallbladder, has a neck, body, and the fundus. Therefore, the hernial sac, this is the hernial sac, protrudes through the defect, formed of this area called the neck, body, and this tip is the fundus. At operation, this hernial sac should be excised at the proper neck. The hernial sac should be excised at the proper neck. At operation, how to identify this neck? The neck of the hernial sac is the narrowest part of the sac. The neck of the hernial sac is the narrowest part of the sac, except it is the narrowest part of the sac if the sac is biriform in shape. The neck is the narrowest, but in direct inguinal hernia and incisional hernia, the hernial sac is hemispherical in shape, leading to wide neck of the sac. Therefore, the neck of the sac is usually the narrowest part of sac, except in direct inguinal hernia and incisional hernia, the neck is wide. The neck of the hernial sac is the part which connects the sac with the generalized peritoneal cavity. It is the site of connection between the hernial sac and the peritoneal cavity. And around the neck of the hernial sac, usually there is condensation of extra peritoneal fat. How? This is the abdominal wall and this is the defect. Okay? And here there is extra peritoneal fat and this is the parietal peritoneum. The extra peritoneal fat is friable, and the increased intra-abdominal pressure will push the parietal peritoneum through the friable extra peritoneal fat. Therefore, the peritoneum protrude outside the defect. The peritoneum protrude outside the defect while extra peritoneal fat, while the friable extra peritoneal fat impacted here around the neck and around the defect. Therefore, increased intra-abdominal pressure will push the peritoneum as hernial sac, and the extra peritoneal fat will be impacted here at the defect around the neck. It should be remembered the very important oral question: what is the hernia without sac? There is a hernia called the fatty hernia of linea alba, has no sac, because this hernia is simply protrusion of extra peritoneal fat through the defect without any peritoneum. Therefore, no hernial sac in fatty hernia of linea alba. Now we know that the hernia formed of defect and formed of hernial sac. What is this inside the sac? Inside the sac is the content of the hernial sac. What is the content of the hernial sac? The content of the hernial sac is summarized mostly in this figure. The commonest hernial sac is hernial sac containing loops of a small intestine. If the content of hernia is a small intestine, the sac. Sac means seal. Therefore, the sac becomes a sac full of a small intestine. And this is called entero, means the intestine. Seal means the sac. Sac containing a small intestine is called entero seal. And the small intestine is the commonest contents for all hernias. Mostly for all hernias. Next to small intestine is greater omentum. If the hernial sac containing omentum, sac means a seal, containing omentum, therefore the sac is called omento seal. Therefore, there is entero seal, hernia containing a small intestine, or omento seal, hernia containing omentum. Clinically, there are many differences, will be mentioned in the clinical picture. There may be a special contents in the hernial sac. The hernial sac may contain two loops of a small intestine. If hernia containing two loops of a small intestine with an intermediate loop inside the abdomen, this is called W hernia because the shape of the content is like letter of W, or Meidel's hernia, which is the name of the scientist described this hernia. Therefore, Meidel's hernia or W hernia, hernia containing double loops of small intestine with intermediate loop connecting the two loops inside the abdomen. The hernia may containing, especially in a small hernia. In a small hernia, first protrude part of circumference of the wall of the intestine, not the whole loop of the intestine, just only part of the wall of the intestine protrude. This is occur in a small hernia, and this is called Richter's hernia in English, but this scientist is German, therefore it is also called Richter's hernia in German. Therefore, Richter's hernia or Richter's hernia is hernia containing part of circumference of the wall of the intestine. A hernia may contain a congenital anomaly called Meckel's diverticulum. If hernia containing Meckel's diverticulum, it is called Letters hernia in English. But this scientist is French scientist, therefore it can also called Lettre hernia in French. Hernia may contain, especially in femoral or direct inguinal hernia, may contain urinary bladder. If part of urinary bladder inside the sac is called cystocoel. Cysto means urinary bladder. These are the contents of hernia. And we should remember that contents of hernia may include any abdominal viscous except pancreas. Why? Pancreas is a retroperitoneal structure fixed to the posterior abdominal wall without any defect anatomically or defect surgically by incisional hernia to occur near the pancreas. Therefore, pancreas fixed retroperitoneal structure away from any incisional scar or away from any anatomical defect. Therefore, no possibility of pancreas to descend in any hernia. But any other abdominal viscous, liver, kidney, any structure may pass in a hernia. This is the contents of the hernia. Finally, the hernia consists of, beside defect, sac and the contents. What is this? This is the structures stretched from the layers of the anterior abdominal wall over the hernial sac. The structures of the anterior abdominal wall stretched over the abdomen, over the hernial sac, is called the coverings of the hernia. Therefore, finally and pathologically, hernia is formed of first a bare defect. Through the defect, protrude and herniate parietal peritoneum as hernial sac. Inside the hernial sac, descend and protrude contents. And all these structures are covered by stretched structures of the anterior abdominal wall, which are the coverings of the hernia. Let us return to the etiology of the hernia. After we know what is the pathology of hernia, and before we leave this point, this is a beautiful picture for the hernial sac, which is formed of fundus, body, neck, and the neck is the narrowest part, which connecting the neck is a hernial sac with the peritoneal cavity. And there is condensation of extra peritoneal fat around the neck. What is the causes of the hernia? The hernia may occur due to congenital sac. If a newly born is born with congenital sac present like that, sure, it is liable for contents to descend at any time, producing congenital hernia. The famous example is congenital oblique inguinal hernia due to congenital sac, or congenital umbilical hernia due to congenital sac. And the congenital sac in oblique inguinal hernia and umbilical hernia will be discussed later on in oblique inguinal hernia and umbilical hernia. The commonest hernia is acquired causes. Acquired causes, why? Why a defect appear in the muscle of the abdominal wall? Usually due to weak muscle. This is the first factor. And why the parietal peritoneum protrude and herniate outside the abdomen? Usually due to increase intra-abdominal pressure. Therefore, there are two important factors for hernia to occur. Acquired hernia require two factors present in the same patient. Weak muscles leading to defect, and increase intra-abdominal pressure to produce herniation and the protrusion of the sac and later on the contents inside the acquired sac. What is the cause of weak abdominal pressure? The commonest cause is obesity. The muscles of the anterior abdominal wall weaks by obesity. Why? In normal patients, the external abdominal oblique is lined by internal abdominal oblique, and the internal abdominal oblique is lined by transverse abdominis, and the muscles are supporting each other. In obesity, fat, excess fat the position between the external abdominal oblique and the internal abdominal oblique. And the excessive fat, the position occur between internal abdominal oblique and the transverse abdominis. Therefore, the muscles become widely separated and supported each other. Excessive obesity leading to the position of fat between the muscle bundles in each muscle, leading to weakness of each muscle. Therefore, each muscle in the abdominal wall becomes weak, and the muscles are weakly supported by the other muscles, leading to obesity. You should remember also that obesity leading to the position of fat inside the abdomen, in the greater omentum, lesser omentum, all folds of peritoneum are big storage of fat. And in obesity also, due to the position of excessive fat in greater omentum and all folds of peritoneum, leading to increase intra-abdominal pressure. Therefore, obesity alone is a main cause for hernia. It weakens the muscle, and it also leading to increased intra-abdominal pressure. Pregnancy is the same. Pregnancy leading to stretch of the muscle, especially in late pregnancy, marked severe stretch of muscles of the anterior abdominal wall, leading to weak muscles. In addition to increased intra-abdominal pressure, therefore pregnancy is a main cause for hernia in females. Senility leading to weakness of muscles. Debility. Weak muscles by incision of an operation. Therefore, any scar of previous abdominal operation is a weak muscle and weak point in the abdominal wall. Or during abdominal incisions, you may injure the nerve supply to a muscle, leading to paralysis of the part of the abdominal wall, leading to weakness and defect in the abdominal wall. There is a famous accident in appendectomy. There is injury of ilioinguinal nerve, leading to devitalization and paralysis of conjoint tendon, which is important cause and the important predisposing factor for direct inguinal hernia. The second cause which occur in patient with hernia is increased intra-abdominal pressure. Increased intra-abdominal pressure may be due to two factors, either chronic straining or chronic abdominal swelling. Chronic straining, why? Straining usually for expulsion of something from inside the body to outside. How? Expulsion of sputum, chronic cough, as in all chest diseases, bronchitis, bronchial asthma, etc. Or expulsion of feces or urine. Feces in chronic constipation. Expulsion of urine in BNO means a bladder neck obstruction. Or BPH, which means benign prostatic hyperplasia, or expulsion of fetus during delivery. Chronic abdominal swelling leading to high abdominal pressure as repeated pregnancy, obesity, hepatosplenomegaly, ascites, or any abdominal tumor, leading to increased intra-abdominal pressure. And you should remember that acquired hernia should need the two factors to be present in the same patient. Weak muscle to occur the defect, for the defect to occur, and the increased intra-abdominal pressure for expulsion of the hernial sac and the content. Thank you for good listening. And